Hello, good evening.
Yeah, it's fine.
Hello, good evening, everybody here online. We are going to start, so pick your coffee, snacks. Please take seats. A very warm welcome to tonight's event. My name is Agnieszka, and together with Rogério Oliveira, I have the pleasure to coordinate the Professional Master in Sustainability Science course at UGI Rio, and also CSRio, which is a Center for Conservation and Sustainability Science here. Tonight's event is co-hosted by UGI Rio, Cambridge University, Museum of Tomorrow of Rio de Janeiro, the International Institute for Sustainability, and re.green. There was a small change regarding the participation of the representatives of the institutions. Unfortunately, Mariela and Ana Lúcia won't be able to participate today, but Ana Lúcia from Globo confirmed her participation in a separate event, in an exclusive event that will be held in July this year. It's a great honor and pleasure to have here with us our distinguished speaker, Professor Andrew Balmford from Cambridge University. Andrew, thank you very much for making time to be here with us tonight. This event will be divided into three parts, followed, of course, by a happy hour. So that all goes smoothly, we count on Dani Neves, a sustainability scientist, and the representative of our alumni. Over to you, Dani.
Thank you, Aga. First, we will begin with Andrew's presentation, which will run for about 50 minutes. During Andrew's presentation, we would like to ask both the in-person and online audience to use the QR code, which is linked to two questions. In the first, we would like you to share some recent news about current environmental problems, asking how they can be tackled with optimism. In the QR code, you should indicate who is going to respond it of our guests. Andrew or one of the representatives of co-hosting institution, Agnieszka Latawiec from PUC, Bernardo Strassburg from re.green, Fabio Scarano from Museum of Tomorrow, and Rafael Loyola from IIS. The problems will be passed over to the speakers to answer it at the end of the talk. The second question we will explain later, so I will translate to Portuguese just to everyone understands. A primeira pergunta que a gente vai apresentar no QR Code vai ser para vocês poderem compartilhar com a gente notícias recentes que são pessimistas com relação à conservação do meio ambiente. E vocês vão direcionar, né, para qual dos representantes das organizações que vocês gostariam que discutisse, conversasse um pouco mais. E a segunda pergunta a gente vai explicar mais à frente. So, Andrew, the floor is yours.
Boa tarde e muito obrigado pela gentil apresentação. And so I must begin by apologizing because I'm going to speak in English, and that's for a very good reason. As you just heard, my Portuguese is appalling, really bad. So I'll do my best to to make myself understood in English instead, as well as thanking Danny for that. I wanted also to thank Agnieszka and Bernardo for all they've done to host me and my wife Sarah here in Kyiv. Since the beginning of the year, they've looked after us. I'm very, very grateful. In case I put you to sleep, which is possible, I'm going to start by summarizing my main point for tonight, right away, which is that I believe that adopting a evidence-based positive messages in conservation is a very important part of making sure that our efforts to conserve biodiversity are going to succeed. I think unless we do that in a cautious way, then we will fail in bringing about the changes in society which we know need to happen. But by being positive and by optimism, I want to make clear that I'm not simply talking about approaching or communicating conservation in a sort of happy, jolly way. That's not what I mean. It's part of it, but it's not enough. I think being upbeat, being positive about the possibilities is only justified, and it can only be credible and therefore have impact if it's supported by the knowledge that conservation can work, and in some instances, many instances, it does work, and that what we do, what we choose to do as professionals or as members of the public, can really make a difference. So I'm really talking about evidence-based positivism, if you like, which I think is critical to a sense of empowerment, what psychologists would call agency. And that's what I mean by cautious and informed optimism. So by showcasing some success stories from around the world, including one or two here in Brazil, I'm going to try to demonstrate that a tone of cautious optimism can be justified, and a conservation can succeed. In one place where progress is clearly being made is right here in the Atlantic Forest, and that's why I've used that map on my title slide. And I'll come back to the matter Atlantica a bit later on. Of course, arguing for optimism in conservation isn't a new idea. David Suzuki. There's going to be some book covers here which demonstrate my point. But David Suzuki argued for a sense of optimism in 2003. Jane Goodall, very famous person, wrote a book about it in 2009. I wrote a book about it in 2012 as well, called Wild Hope, which I might come back to later. I'm contractually obliged to plug the book. I wrote a book about it in about a decade ago. I think it's reasonable to start by asking, though, if there's been that history, those arguments made as to why optimism is important, why it's not really become part of the conservation mainstream. Why do most conservation organizations primarily focus on the bad news? I think one reason is that the media doesn't help. The media likes bad news stories. They don't like reporting good news stories. They don't sell, that doesn't sell newspapers, they think. It doesn't generate clickbait online as well as doom and gloom stories. But I think as conservationists as well, we ourselves don't help that. If you look at fundraising campaigns by conservation organizations, they very typically start with messages about threats. If you think about the science in terms of research, if you just look down the contents pages of journals, it turns out that we publish much more often on problems in conservation. Now, I understand why we do that. Those problems are often generic. You can make big stories. You can sell those to big journals. Solutions, in contrast, are typically really quite messy. They're often case-specific. They can take years to devise a solution, to implement it, to test it, and then to report on it. And at the end, you have a context-specific answer. So that's not very good for your scientific career. I think that's another problem. On top of that, as conservationists, we usually feel compelled, I think, to keep reiterating the message to the public that there is a real problem. So when I went about researching my book, you might see the cover of it here in a few minutes' time, but when I set about doing the research for my book and I asked colleagues for good news stories, which I could go and investigate, many of them wrote to me and said, Andrew, this is a bad thing to do. You're making a mistake. You need to be focusing on the bad news. You need to get that message across. And I completely understand that viewpoint. As long as the opponents of conservation and of the environment keep telling us that nature is not in trouble, as long as they deny what's happening, we, as a group of scientists, communicators, of advocates, we feel it's essential, first of all, to remind the public of how bad the situation is. We feel we have to do that. It's our duty. And so to stave off any criticism that I'm being too jolly, too happy this evening, and simply ignoring how grave the situation is, I'm going to spend a few minutes channeling my inner gloomy conservationist and telling you some bad news stories. Just wondering whether, first of all, I should help fix the slides, because these will come in. Do you want another set of slides, Bernardo?
I will not first.
I've got on this thing, if that helps.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, it's a low-tech. It's a low-tech, that suits me. Sort the folder by concerts. It's not got a folder, it just tells you. And then you sort it by data, this most piece of front.
Okay, so what I'm going to do while Bernardo is coming to my rescue is show you four examples of bad news, just to make sure that, you know, I'm on the same page. So I know there is bad news and I need to
think of data.
I'm going to give four examples, and there's one from each of the main, what I see as the major threats to biodiversity. First of all, in terms of over-exploitation of nature, one of the major threats, this is the example of the vaquita in, here we go. I'm going to start talking about some real threats, so you know where I'm coming from. I know there is a problem. And I'm going to just tell you about some dreadful things. You might not know these stories, you might. And each one is going to be associated with one particular threat. So this is what's, in terms of over-harvesting, as one example, this is what's happened to the global population of the world's smallest cetacean over the course of the past 25 years. These vaquita in the Gulf of Mexico are down to 8 individuals at the latest count. They will go extinct. There's no doubt they will go extinct, and they will go extinct as a result of getting caught in nets, which are set in the Gulf of California completely illegally to catch a highly valued fish called the totoaba, which is worth $40,000 per fish when you get it to China. This thing has no future. It will go extinct. When it goes extinct, it will join this species, Rab's fringe-limbed tree frog, which is a victim of chytridiomycosis, an invasive fungus This individual, the last known individual, is extinct in the wild, and the last one died in captivity in 2016. Those are two major threats. Of course, the biggest threat to biodiversity is habitat loss. There's just one example of that. There's been more than 65% loss since the 1950s of mudflats in the Yellow Sea. Not an example people know about very well, but devastating nonetheless. And it's through a combination of land reclamation for development, but also as a consequence of the installation of very large dams in the rivers that feed this part of the world. And the putting of the dam in place means there's no longer a source of silt coming down the river, which replenishes the mudflats. Devastating consequences for all sorts of creatures, including migrating birds. And as a final example, here's one, the Bramble Cave Nila mice, which is the first known mammalian casualty of climate change, a species whose island home has disappeared under the waves and which went extinct somewhere around 15 years ago. Those are examples of what I think of as the four main threats. You may have a different set, but we know what the threats are. We also know about the underlying drivers of our society that are responsible for those threats. In my head, they come in four main flavors. The really important thing I want to note about those underlying drivers, though, is that they're all about our behavior, all about what we do as people. Obviously, most talked about, there's the size and the rapid growth of the human population. Even more significant, though, if you look at the numbers in terms of its impact, there's a seemingly unquenchable desire to have ever higher standards of living. Now, that's essential for much of the world's population that lives in circumstances that you and I would find very difficult. But I think that's something that's far more questionable among the rest of us who are, relatively speaking, pretty well off, pretty comfortable. So why do we need more? Then there's the problem that when we make choices of all sorts, we tend to put ourselves above future generations, and we put ourselves above people living elsewhere. And those patterns of human behavior lead to what economists term discounting and the creation of negative externalities. Finally, there's a growing disconnect from nature. Well, this is my son, Ben, 29 years ago. We just visited him. He's brilliant. This was him, aged a few months, out with his binoculars. And he's absolutely brilliant in our eyes. We think he's very lovely. But he's also, we would admit, probably a bit unusual in that he is quite closely connected with late nature. He's even more closely connected and passionate about it than he was in that picture. He's pretty unusual. And to give you an example of what's happening more widely, this is a map which shows one really important reason why, instead of connection, disconnection is becoming the rule. This is a map which I stole from a newspaper, which shows the home range sizes of four generations of the same family living in the north of England when each of them was 8 years old. This is the home range size of the great-grandfather, who, when he was 18, was allowed to walk about 10 kilometres by himself, unaccompanied by an adult, to go fishing. This is the home range size of his son, the grandfather in this family, who was allowed to walk about 1.5 kilometres by himself. He then allowed his daughter to walk half a mile, so 700 metres to go to the swimming pool when she was a child in 1979. This is then the home range size of the great-grandson. He's allowed to go 300 metres to the end of the shops, aged 8. And this is the UK, but I suspect that is typical of lots and lots of societies around the world. And if it is, then it's no surprise that we're becoming disconnected from nature and we're losing touch with wild places and wild creatures. So my point here is just to say, we know about the drivers as well. We know about the threats, we know about the drivers. And they seem, if you think about it, pretty unstoppable. How are we going to stop those things? But I want you to ask yourself a question. How does seeing more about those threats make you feel? You're committed conservationists. What does it do to you to see more of those? And more importantly than that, what's the likely effect going to be on members of the general public? Well, we've got a pretty good answer to that question already. It comes from a load of other fields and studies from a range of different fields, from healthcare to road safety to crime. A whole series of different enterprises shows us that negative messaging, persistent exposure to consistent negative messages, doesn't galvanize us into action. It doesn't make us want to change. Instead, what it does is it makes us deny what's happening. It makes us say it's not happening, and we become inward-looking and defensive. We need outward-looking behavior change, but we know from a whole load of different fields that that's not what negative messages result in. Just one example from conservation comes from an experiment I was involved with a few years ago with a fantastic psychologist called Netta Weinstein. And this confirms this broad conclusion in a conservation context, but it also sheds some light on what we might do about it. What we found in these bars here is that when we showed people identical nature videos, which were had messages accompanying them, which were aimed at connecting people with nature. So that's the green bars. When we showed them those things, compared with when we showed them they have no text, which is the grey, or when we gave them negative threatening messages in the red, we found that giving them those connecting messages reduced what psychologists call negative affect, that's unhappiness. They were less unhappy if they saw a connecting message. And when we asked them how they felt about the creatures that were described in the film, they were more likely to say that they cared about them if they'd seen these connecting messages than if they saw no or negative messages. And really interestingly, in the third plot, when presented after this experiment was over, because psychology experiments are never quite over, there's always a trick at the end. We left them with a screensaver, which happened to have a connection on it to the WWF website. People who got the connecting message were more likely to click on that link, and they're more likely to spend time browsing that website, just because we changed the words in the message. And that's, of course, I think, starts to show where hope comes in. Hope in conservation was the theme of no fewer than 25 events called Earth Optimism, which were brought together by an amazing person called Nancy Knowlton. They took place over one weekend in April 2017. As you can see from the map, most of them were in the US, but they were elsewhere as well. We hosted an event with Sir David Attenborough in Cambridge. And there were simultaneous events, as you can see, in Latin America and Australia. Because Nancy is an incredible woman and very well, people don't say no to Nancy. She even managed to get a simultaneous event going on the International Space Station. And everyone was linked up around the world, talking about the importance of positive messaging and conservation. Despite the pandemic, in 2021, there were again multiple Earth Optimism events around the world, most of them online. Fernanda Gomez and colleagues organized Optimismo Planetario here in Rio. In Cambridge, we put together a virtual Earth Optimism Festival, had lots and lots of online talks, short films, interviews, and so on. All of that material, if you're interested, for our event and many of the other events, is still available online. And all of that material is about celebrating examples where things are getting better and not worse. My own take on reasons to be cheerful, and what I want to focus on for the rest of my time, is that those reasons fall into two categories. First of all, there are several practical reasons why I think we must be cheerful, why we have to be positive in our communications. These are practical reasons, in my view, why the conservation movement needs to have pragmatic positivism in its messaging. And I think there are three sets of reasons for identifying and celebrating success, and I'll go through them. One of them in more detail, but just to mention them and summarize them now. One is that it's important so that we can understand and replicate what works. Second, I think we need to celebrate success in order to hold on to our existing achievements. And crucially, and most importantly, as was suggested by that psychology study, I think we need to celebrate success if we are going to inspire and empower members of the public to change. And if we don't do that, we will undoubtedly fail. I think these reasons, and I'll go through them, I think they're all really important, and so I put them in red. And then alongside those practical reasons why I think we have to do this, there are a set of reasons as to why we can talk about success, which are the success stories themselves, the evidence that conservation can work. And those really provide the basis for justifying an attitude of being at least somewhat optimistic, not denying the bad news, but saying that we can make a difference. And these success stories, I view as really rays of sunshine in a fairly gloomy world. And so I've colored them here in yellow, and I'll use that red and yellow summarizing as I go through that red and yellow coding as I go through exploring those examples in turn. I'm going to divide the rest of my talk into two parallel strands. I hope this isn't going to be too confusing, but I'm going to intersperse these red arguments as to why we need hope with some of those optimistic stories flagged in yellow. Reasons for each of the three threats as to why, examples for each of the three threats where things are getting better, not worse. Some of those positive stories, the ones in yellow, will be familiar to you, I'm sure, but I nevertheless think they're worth repeating. So I'm going to start off with a panel of success stories about the first of those threats that I talked about, which is overexploitation. Some good news in overexploitation. My first example comes from Assam in India. And here, despite, as we all know, huge and growing poaching pressure on rhinos, a combination there of extraordinary tolerance of wildlife among local communities in Assam, that combined with very strong controversial fortress-style conservation. Those two things, benign local attitudes and very forceful efforts at conservation involving governments, saw the world's largest population of great Indian rhinos increase by 700% in 50 years, which is remarkable. Very different example, out at sea, grave concerns about the impacts of longlining and of trawling operations that attract and accidentally drag down and drown scavenging albatrosses. Those have led to really clever deployments, technical solutions to avoid this problem. Bird scaring lines towed behind a boat, weighted lines that sink faster so they disappear from the birds more quickly. And now, 10 different studies of their effectiveness from around the southern oceans are reporting huge declines in seabird bycatch from fishing vessels when these technologies are put into place. Final example of a success story in the context of overexploitation. This plot shows what happened after 2012 to imports of shark fins into Hong Kong. That's the main entry point for shark fins into China. Now, the explanation for this pattern is unclear. There's been a government clampdown on luxury food items, part of an anti-corruption drive. There have been very high-profile campaigns by Chinese sports stars saying we shouldn't be eating shark fins. There have been food scandals, which have put people off eating them. And then on top of that, there's been changes in the labelling regimes, which mean that actually what's going on might not be as marked as this pattern shows. But it's still a prominent decline, and I think it's good news for conservation. And in a context where all I've ever heard about shark finning is that it's a disaster. Actually, it's not as bad as it was 10 or 15 years ago. However, the difficulty that I've just outlined in trying to understand the cause of this decline, I've given four different answers and I don't know which one is right. The difficulty in understanding the causality raises the first, really, of my red arguments as to why we need to think about positive stories, why we need to consider as scientists conservation successes. We need to document the progress as a first step in beginning to understand what works and why it's working. We need that if we're going to replicate and scale up best practice. So as an example of that, here's an analysis by marine scientist David Gill. He looked at how well marine protected areas, how they impact fish. He measured it as something called, as they call a response ratio, and that's the biomass of fish inside a marine protected area versus outside it, the ratio of those two, or the ratio of fish in the same area after a reserve was declared compared with before. That's the response ratio that he's plotting here. There's two important results from his study. The first of those is that the vast majority of the marine protected areas they look at have blue-coded points. That is to say, they have positive response ratios. They seem to be boosting fish biomass, on average, in this case, by about 70%. So that's some more good news. But second, when he dug down, he found that the performance of marine protected areas varies a lot between different sites. And in particular, it co-varies with budget and with staffing. So for that, those MPAs, marine protected areas, which reported those things, he found that those with no staff at the top had no effect whatsoever. On the other hand, the bottom, those which had adequate staffing, they were roughly three times as effective as those which had some staffing, but not enough. And that result was the same whether he looked at those which were exclusive no-take reserves and those which permitted multi-uses. So there's a very clear signal from his finding, not only that marine protected areas can work, but what we need to do to make them more effective. We need to staff them properly. So there's, by studying success, we can identify what works. We have the potential replicate those successes. That's the first of my points about why, as conservationists, I think we have to think about things that work. Before moving on to another red reason about why I think we have to be positive, I'm going to move on to another, I'm going to intersperse that with another panel of success stories. And this time I'm going to think about invasive species, another thread. And the notion that I just showed you in the, from the marine protected areas example of establishing what works and then replicating it, that's characteristic of many good news stories resulting from efforts to tackle the threats from invasive species. So as one example, because of predation by feral cats, Ascension Island frigate birds, the world's rarest frigate birds, have been unable to nest on Ascension Island's main island for almost 200 years. Instead, they were entirely restricted for that time to a very, very small offshore islet, making them very vulnerable. Then the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds came along. Ascension Island, I should explain, is one of those strange places that's still a British protectorate, even though it's thousands of miles away. So RSPB, our biggest conservation NGO, got involved. They spent years eradicating cats from the island. And in 2006, the island was cat-free, no more feral cats. The first frigate birds then shifted from this tiny offshore island back onto the main island 6 years later. By 2015, there were 150 pairs where there'd been none for 200 years. By 2020, there were almost 1,500 pairs of one of the world's rarest seabirds. Rapidly growing understanding, expertise about how to control invasive cats, rats, mice, rabbits, meant the total number of islands like Ascension, which have been cleared cleanly of their non-native invading mammals. That's risen dramatically over the past 30 years. Hundreds and hundreds of species benefit from that. Seabirds, most obviously, but also endemic island plants, insects, these incredibly unusual reptiles, the tuataras in New Zealand. And those methods of how to get invasive mammals out from a system and keep them out aren't only being applied to islands. This shows that on the Australian mainland, populations of endangered and critically endangered native mammals and birds, which have become severely threatened over the past century by foxes and cats, they're now starting to recover in a growing number of what are called mainland islands. These are large, well-fenced reserves. They keep species like this bilby, which would otherwise probably be extinct, safe from the impacts of exotic predators. Of course, the problem with invasive species is it doesn't stop. It never ends. You need unending vigilance once you've cleared your island of rats to stop them coming back. You need to make sure that the problem doesn't return. And I think not losing what you've worked so hard to achieve is a general problem, a general issue, a challenge in conservation. And it's another one of my red-coded reasons as to why we have to study and celebrate success. So what I want to do just for a minute is introduce an idea which I call positive shifting baselines. Many of you will be familiar with the idea of negative shifting baselines. That's forgetting what we've lost, forgetting there was ever a wonderful creature like Stella's sea cow or mastodons or things like that. We forget that we've lost. Positive shifting baselines, on the other hand, are about forgetting what we've won, forgetting about something that we won that was very hard to win. And I'm going to give you a non-conservation example. Very few people nowadays can imagine living in a world in which women are not allowed to vote. Norms have changed. It's impossible to think that we could return to that situation. But positive shift. So yeah, baseline has shifted in a positive direction. I think that positive shifting baselines, on the one hand, they're clearly a reflection of something great that has happened. It's so fundamental that we can't imagine going back. But on the other hand, I think forgetting we've fought to win can also be a risk. So I'm going to shift to a conservation example from the UK and talk about the recovery of raptors, of birds of prey. Now, when I was a child, which wasn't that long ago, but when I was a child, decades of direct persecution and the devastating effects of pesticides like DDT meant that across Britain, seeing what were our native birds of prey, which once used to be common, things like buzzards and sparrowhawks, that was really noteworthy. If I saw a buzzard, I would run home and write it down. I was really excited. I saw a sparrowhawk today. That was really unusual. Since then, huge sustained campaign efforts have led to the banning of many pesticides and the greater enforcement of laws against persecution. And in due course, we've seen the return of many raptors to our skies. Buzzards like this, sparrowhawks, red kites, peregrine falcons. I can see those every single day of my life now in the UK. And that's absolutely wonderful. It makes my heart sing. It's tremendous. But it also means that a sense of excitement has inevitably given way to a sense of familiarity. And nowadays, I think many people have become a bit blasé about this. That's seeing raptors is the new normal. Now, of course, part of me thinks, that's brilliant. How fantastic. These birds absolutely should be part of our everyday experience. But if a shifted baseline leads to forgetfulness about how hard it really was for people to bring about changes in the law and make those conservation concerns, and make those conservation gains, then we risk those gains being reversed. And in England, we're doing exactly that. Natural England, which is our national conservation agency, is now licensing gamekeepers to cull buzzards in order to protect the pheasants that they want their clients to be able to shoot. So we have a situation sanctioned by the government, indeed enforced by the government, where we are sanctioning the killing of a still recovering bird of prey, which is nowhere near its natural abundance, a native species, in order to defend the economic interests of a shooting industry that still releases nearly 60 million of these non-native bird species every year into our countryside in order to kill them. And similar efforts, I'm sure you can think of many, to reverse hard-won conservation gains. They lie at the heart of calls to cull recovering seal populations, wolf populations in Europe and in the United States. They also were behind a 2016 attempt to unpick the European Union's Birds and Habitats Directives. These are the strongest conservation laws anywhere in Europe. And in this case, measuring the performance of conservation actions, finding out whether they were, turned out to be incredibly valuable. This is some work by Fiona Sanderson and colleagues at the RSPB. What this plot shows is population trends in species birds that are either listed on Annex 1 of the Birds Directive, so they're protected by this law in green, or if they're not listed, and changes in their population size over a decade. You see a strong marked difference in those population trends, whether they're protected or not. Not only that, this effect size, this difference between the red and green bars, was stronger in those countries which have been in the European Union for longer. These are countries which weren't exposed to that law for as long, the benefit was not as great. So it's pretty good quantitative evidence, it's as good as you're going to get, that these laws really did work. And it turned out that dissecting those effects was critical in resisting those efforts to repeal or at least water down that legislation. So I argue that we need to document what conservation has achieved if we're going to defend it against attempts to reverse it. Moving on, one of the main ways in which European Union directives work is through providing funding to tackle the biggest of all threats to biodiversity, which is the third one I'm going to provide some success stories about, which is habitat loss. And there's one European example this work. This is a bird called the bittern. In the UK, this bird was down by 1996. Drainage of wetlands and poor management of remaining wetlands meant that the whole of the UK supported 11 males of this bird. We know exactly how many there were because they've got an incredibly loud voice. Everybody knows when they've got a bittern nearby. And RSPB count across the whole country, there were just 11 of those birds. And then a wonderful institution called the European Union gave the UK two very large grants to both manage existing wetlands better and to create new wetlands. That enabled the population to rise 2,000% in just 20 years. Last year, there were over 200 booming male bitterns in the UK, and the population is still rising. Of course, effective habitat protection and restoration is underway in many other places as well. Everyone here knows, while other biomes in Brazil are continuing to shrink, the Atlantic forest, though still only a fraction of what it was before European arrival, has, according to map biomass data, been expanding steadily since 2005. 2005, of course, when the law banning further deforestation in the Mata Atlantica was approved by Congress. And what that means is that further losses have decreased, and now they're being exceeded both by natural regeneration and, of course, by huge efforts being put into habitat restoration. One of many positive consequences of that extraordinary achievement is shown here, where through a combination of reintroductions of captive bred animals and very strategic restoration of corridors which link remaining habitat fragments, the global population of golden lion tamarins, it has increased to the point where their global threat status was downgraded from being critically endangered to endangered. In 2016, habitat improvements in a very different part of the world, in Western China, led to similar downlisting of the giant panda. And China's interesting because it obviously presents many other conservation challenges. But while environmental legislation elsewhere is under threat, certainly in my country, in the United States and other places, habitat protection in China seems to be getting stronger. Of course, habitat restoration and protection, like all the other things in conservation, doesn't come cheap. It needs public money and it needs political support. For me, this highlights third very practical reason why adopting a positive narrative in conservation is vital. And that's that good news inspires people to support their governments, to support government investments in conservation, and also to put their own money and time behind campaigns. So I'm going to move away for a moment, away from conservation, and talk to you about something very strange, peculiar British event called Comic Relief. I don't know if any of you have come across this. It's what we call a telethon. It's a UK biennial event. It's a television fundraising event. It began about 25 years ago. Since then, it's raised over £1 billion in tiny donations from the general public. And it has one night every 2 years to do that. So it's an extraordinary achievement. Well, how does it do it? What it does is it uses short films, which are broadcast during the course of an evening, which provide really moving, heart-rending profiles of human suffering, sometimes in the UK, sometimes in Africa. Those are the two places they operate. But they follow those films, which make you feel awful. You watch them and you feel guilty and sad, and what can I do? The minute the film ends, they then show you something else, which is a film about what the money that was given 2 years ago has done to change that situation. So you feel bad, and straight away, you get the answer, this is what I can do right now to stop feeling bad. And you went home not realizing Comic Relief was on the telly. By the end of the evening, you've sent them $100 that you had no intention of sending them. It works. It works. And that's the evidence, showing people the problems, but also showing them as an answer right now that they can do something about. That help can be about money, but it can also be important help in other ways. And as an example of that in conservation, the evidence that I showed you that the European Union's conservation laws, the evidence that those work, that was sent out through conservation organisations around the whole of Europe. That led to 500,000 people picking up a pen and writing to their representative in Brussels in defence of the Birds and Habitats Directive. That really shocked politicians. That was more people than had ever contacted Brussels about anything ever since it began, 1950, whenever it was. And they realised people cared, and they realised that people had the evidence to show them that the legislation worked. And it succeeded in preventing that legislation being put down. Going back to biodiversity loss more generally and the underlying drivers of biodiversity loss, I think tackling each of those is about empowering and encouraging all of us to change our personal behaviour, to make changes in our everyday lives, decisions about how we power our homes, what we decide, how we travel, what we do in our spare time. Whether or not we can avert the extinction crisis, I think, is going to depend in large measure on the choices that we as individuals make. Our governments too, but we as individuals also need to change our behaviour and make difficult decisions that are going to require us to make some sacrifices as well. And I think key to that is knowing that those changes make a real difference. If we don't believe that, if we think we're unimportant or that change doesn't really matter, we won't make the change. If we don't make the change, I think we will fail in conservation. That's almost all I'm going to say, but there's one major threat you may have noticed I haven't talked about, one where people perhaps feel least empowered and most hopeless, and that's climate change. But even here, I think things are changing, in some cases, surprisingly fast. So, against the backdrop over much of the past decade of shrinking support for renewable energies in some countries, particularly in the United States, in 2016, India went ahead and unveiled the world's largest solar park. Not to be outdone, of course, China couldn't let that happen. So 4 months later, China went ahead and unveiled one that was even bigger. And since then, the Indians have hit back, and now they have three that are even bigger. And the rate of progress towards renewables, particularly in China, is utterly extraordinary. And but it's something that we don't hear about, certainly not in the UK. We do not hear about China doing the right thing. By April last year, China had more wind turbine capacity than the next seven highest countries combined. It had more utility-scale solar generation than the whole of the rest of the world put together. By 2030, when every country set a renewables target for 2030, China will hit its target. In fact, it will reach its 2030 target for renewables by 2025. It's likely that no other country in the world will meet its 2030 target. China will reach its target next year. And partly as a result of those efforts, greenhouse gas emissions per dollar of GDP have fallen more steeply in China than in any other major economy. They're now at around 25% of their 1990 levels. That's not to say that China isn't a huge polluter. It's just to say that they are trying to do some of the right things, and in ways and at levels that most of us have never heard of. And there are some biological glimmers of hope on the climate change front as well. This shows what many of you be familiar with, what a coral reef can become after a heat-induced bleaching event. The corals die, macroalgae, seaweeds take over. So there's a regime shift. We've lost a coral reef. But work in the Seychelles, where bleaching reduced live coral cover by 90% in a few weeks in 1998, that work found that over half of the reefs then recovered. They went back to being coral reefs. And importantly, that, whether or not they reverted, had a predictable pattern. So these are those results. And those reefs that had, before the bleaching event, had decent structural complexity. So the reefs over on the right of that plot, those did not undergo a regime shift to seaweeds. They bleached, but they recovered. What that means is that if we can retain the structural complexity of coral reefs, if we can retain that level of heterogeneity, then they too have a chance of surviving heat-induced bleaching. So what does all this tell us? I'm going to come up with some conclusions and some caveats. I'm going to overlay them with photos of delegates at something called the Student Conference on Conservation Science, which is an annual event which we run in Cambridge, which brings together masters and PhD students from across the world to talk about their work. Every year we have about 10 to 20 delegates from Brazil. If you know of students, graduate students doing postgraduate studies who might benefit, please look for this site and send them our way. We would welcome them. And the student conference gives me another reason for hope, which I haven't really mentioned, and that's the passion and the skills of growing numbers of young people who are becoming conservation professionals. So by way of winding up, I want to flag some very important caveats. The examples of conservation success I've given, so those yellow rays of sunshine I've worked through, they're not typical. They're not representative of what's happening to nature. I know that. I went out and cherry-picked. I picked them. There are many more failures than there are successes. On top of that, the successes we have are not perfect. Having gunfights to protect rhinos, or poisoning tens of thousands of rats in order to restore island seabirds, those are morally difficult decisions. They're complicated. And potentially promising interventions like building massive solar farms, those can have substantial negative effects as well. I'm certainly not trying to say that most species or places are secure. If we look at the big picture, we're clearly not doing anywhere near enough to save wild nature. And in particular, we're not making enough progress to tackle those behavioral and structural drivers of its decline, which I started talking about at the beginning. Those are going to require fundamental changes in human behavior, in the ways in which societies are organized. They'll take a long time. However, there are many examples of conservation successes out there. They come from a very varied mix of situations. They come from rich countries, from poorer countries. They come across the spectrum of different types of threats. They come from places where we might be used to thinking conservation doesn't work there. But actually, there will be cases, will be examples in those countries where conservation is succeeding. And I would argue that understanding those and celebrating them among the conservation community, but more importantly, with the general public, I think that doing so can help us hold on to what the conservation movement's achieved. It can teach us how to replicate those successes more widely. It can help us to secure public support and those behavioral shifts. But if we can do that, I think there's every chance that we can buy time. I think we're in a situation where we need to buy time for those more fundamental societal changes that we undoubtedly need if we're going to tackle the underlying drivers of threat. A friend of mine, colleague Debbie Payne, explained to me that both positivism and negativism are great spirals of thinking and of actions. Being positive inspires people to take on new challenges and make those challenges work. Being negative, on the other hand, because things are difficult, I think that leads us to give up completely. We are still very much losing the war against nature's decline. But of course, this is not a war that we can afford to lose. We cannot lose this. And as conservationists, I think we have something of a choice. We can continue to focus our messaging, our communications on very largely highlighting the crisis, or we can choose, as well as still being cautious and concerned and saying there's a problem, we can choose to investigate and celebrate success and try to nurture a cautious spirit of hope. I think if we're going to secure our achievements to date, if we're going to build on them, if we're going to buy time for those fundamental changes that we know are needed, I think a more optimistic approach is essential. Well, to leave you just with this person, when they sought to inspire a world in a very difficult situation, Martin Luther King spoke of having a dream. He didn't tell the world he had a problem. He told the world he had a dream. And I think we should do the same. If you want to see any more on reasons to be cheerful, there are some references here. There's a website at the bottom. And I just want to mention that the book I talked about, Wild Hope, was recently developed into I was really pleased. It got developed into a TV series in the United States, which has a series of episodes. It's just launched. It launched last summer. There's another series just coming out at the moment. They're available on the PBS Public Broadcasting Service website for free. The new series has two stories from Brazil, in fact, from right here. So it has one about what's going on in Tijuca, and another one which came out last week, I think, celebrating the Golden Lion tamarind story. So if you want, you feel like cheering yourself up, then go to that website. They're lovely stories. I can say that because I didn't have any part in them. But they've been beautifully made, and they're very well written. Thank you very much.
Andrew, we would like to express our deepest gratitude for your insightful presentation, which has highlighted the crucial significance of optimism in biodiversity conservation. Thank you for sharing your valuable knowledge with us. Now, I would like to invite our guests, representatives of cohort host this institution to start the debate. First, we would like to invite Agnieszka Latawiec, representing Cook Hill, to join us on stage. Environmental scientist from the University of East Anglia, UK, she holds the position of Associate Professor at the Department of Geography and Environment at Cook Hill and coordinator of the Professional Master in Sustainability Science at the same university. Next, we have Bernardo Strassburg, who is the founder and chief scientist at re.green. He is a professor of the Professional Master's Degree in Sustainability Science, co-developer of the National Restoration Plan. He's a member of the United Nations Scientific Council for the Decade of Ecosystem Restoration. He also led the development of new global restoration target for the UN Convention of Biodiversity, CBD, along with the Global Priority Region for Restoration. Our third guest is Fabio Scarano from Museum of Tomorrow, who served as a curator and professor of the UNESCO Chair for Literacy in Futures. He was one of the creators of the Professional Master's Degrees in Sustainability Science, and he's a professor on the permanent board of the Master's Degrees course. He was the lead author for the first report of the Brazilian panel on climate change for the fifth assessment report of the IPCC, International Panel on Climate Change, and coordinating lead author from the IPCC, International Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Service. And last but not least, we have Rafael Loyola representing IIS as an executive director. He has a solid background in people and project management and extensive knowledge in fundraising and structuring research and development projects. Furthermore, he was the science director at the Brazilian Foundation for Sustainable Development. Now, I will invite the audience again here and online to use the QR code to share some recent facts and news about current environment problems and indicate that who of our guests should respond how they can be tackled with optimism. These questions will then be addressed to the representatives. Falando em português, mais uma última vez, a gente vai pedir para vocês, a partir do código do QR Code, poderem compartilhar notícias recentes ou fatos sobre problemas ambientais, né, que são existentes, e indicar quem dos nossos representantes queridos aqui que vai poder responder como abordar, como enfrentar esses desafios. Então é isso. Sorry, the main lecture. Sorry.
We see some questions already. Andrea, the first one is to Agnieszka. How do universities and master's programs prepare students to deal with negative news? I'm not sure about all universities and all courses, but from our experience here, I think by helping solving complex problems, I think that empowering students with the knowledge of how to use science and solve complex systems, it can be very empowering. So, yeah, I think it's not a maybe direct answer, how do we deal with negative things, but how we feel empowered by knowing that we have capacity when we,
when we need to solve a complex problem, and they will be appearing. But we know that by looking at systems and system thinking, and this is something that is very linked with sustainability science course and environmental science course, when we look at the systems and we look at the complexity, but we also know how we can that we can solve it. So I think it's a very recent trend in teaching, and I think it is very positive.
Thank you. Question for Fabio. We recently received news that the Committee of the International Union of Geological Sciences did not recognize the Anthropocene as a geological era. How do we respond to this?
I think that the question is, what's the time we're living in? I think it's actually, well, it's okay that they were negative about the name, but everybody feels that we are living through strange times. And then I think it poses the question, what is the time we're living through? And I think, of course, science, I think, loses a bit of space in this discussion, because science is so disciplinary that it's up to 20 geologists to decide what's the name of the times we are going through. So I see it in a positive way. Irrespective of the brilliant talk we just saw. Thanks, Andrew.
Thank you, Fabio. Question for Rafael. Rio de Janeiro faces serious and recurring problems with disasters due to heavy rainfall. The state government has laws and technical foundations to mitigate the issue, such as the Climate Change Adaptation Plan created by IAS in 2018. But these haven't been implemented in practice until now. How can one remain optimistic when, even with design solutions, there is no political interest in addressing social environmental issues like this?
Yeah. We should, yeah. Thank you for the lecture. I have a question to Andrew after the class. Not messing up everything. Yes, I think it's tough. That's what Andrew said. I mean, it's tough, but you got to focus on the positive message of what is happening. In the particular case of climate change and what is happening in Rio, I think we're gaining momentum. I mean, yes, it could be a little bit not cheerful or not very encouraging that we have a plan and we're not implementing the plan, but, you know, there is the political time, there is a political will, and things will happen in a given time. We can push, society can work to make it happen. We can discuss with the politicians. Just last week, we had a public audience discussing how the plan will be implemented. So yes, it could be tough, but on the positive side, and on the positive message, we already have a plan. This plan is backed up by science, as Andrew said. So it is a good example of a science supported material that can be used and is ready to be used. And that's it. I think we need to remain positive that we can drive change. And if this change is backed up by some kind of very good or science-based information, that's better. The thing is, it's not necessarily our timing. Things happening in a time that is very slow to some people, but that's the thing. Can I ask something to Andrew?
Of course.
It will be about that first question to Aga. You mentioned the conference in Cambridge and you teach there. Is there some specific topic that you obviously, but that you address in the course in Cambridge for? Are you actually discussing that on classes with students?
No. I mean, we try and talk about what works, we try very hard, like courses here. We're very lucky. We have some great students, and some students who are very interested in conservation. We have a world class, so there are other things as well. We try in the academic part of the course, the conservation science course that I help run, we cover lots of ground and we talk about problems and we talk about possible solutions. We try and do so in a balanced way, and we say, you know, we can do this, here's the evidence that this works. This is actually what our government's doing and other governments are doing. So we have that tension, but we do try and not just fill them with values. And I know they're the same here. You know, students can get depressed, and I understand that. But if you, and so I think it's helpful just to, but also I think positively, we're responsible for training them to be able to do this. The other thing we do, which I find very encouraging, is each year we have a class of 100, and probably when I first started in Cambridge, maybe five of those went on to conservation, a small course. Now I think probably 25 or 30 go on into conservation careers, and we know because we follow them. And then what we do is we bring them back to talk to our students, so that those students who are potentially interested, some of whom might be a bit put off by the prospect of, you know, a career which is about trying to tackle a real problem, they can see, actually, no, I can make a difference. But they can also do that in a rather realistic way. They, you know, there's a danger that, you know, and certainly when I was 21, I thought I could change the world. But now I realize I can't change the world. I can just maybe influence a little bit of it, having that sense of, you can make a difference. This is how I made a difference. I was at your place 5 years ago. But I'm managing to make this bit of a difference can help temper, create a sense of realistic. A realistic prospect you can, that you can, this is the career for you. I think that can help a bit, and I'm sure it probably can.
So cookie is better because we have a discipline that is actually focused on that. So it's a discipline at the Department of Geography. It's called Paisages in Transition. And actually, we are with Thomas, who is now also one of our students. I saw other students that are not frequenting the class. We are looking at the problems. So, what are each class is a case study. When we, for example, last week we were analyzing the case of snow leopard and how was it successful, how was it sorted. So, yeah, we have a full discipline that is looking into complex problems regarding conservation, but regarding also social issues in landscape. And then we focus on the lessons learned, what led to the positive outcome. So, sorry to hear, Andrew. I can show you.
We have a storm of bad news coming through the questions, so prepare. Despite of largest scale restoration initiatives like re.green currently being implemented in Brazil, we saw recently a case of 80,000 hectares chemically deforesting Pantanal by a cattle rancher. Furthermore, according to INPEM, over 60% of Amazon, the areas in Amazon being naturally regenerated, they are being deforested again. How to tackle with optimism? Is it possible to achieve net zero deforestation only with restoration?
I thought this was the optimistic
view.
So no, the answer, you can't achieve net zero only with reforestation, because that's only half of the equation. So to achieve net zero, it's very important to couple restoration with conservation measures. And we always write, and we always say, if you had to choose one thing, that would be conservation. So conservation is the most important action to be taken. So I saw the news about the Pantanal hard rendering using napalm to deforest Pantanal. So absolutely. We're trying to shift a bit to the topic of the night, of the evening. Yes, that was a terrible deforestation event. But Brazil, for the second time in just over a decade, has shown, under the leadership of the same environmental minister, Marina, that we can make profound and rapid changes that matter at a planetary scale. The 80% reduction in deforestation that Brazil experienced between 2004 and 2008 is regarded as the largest single contribution to climate change mitigation that one pack of policies have ever made, not to mention all the biodiversity consequences of that. And just over in 1 year back in government, we saw the rapid decrease in deforestation in the Amazon. As we say for a long time, and many others have written attention to Cerrado, to Pantanal, it's still lacking. So we need to transfer that great experience from the Amazon to the other biomes. Now, going about restoration, we understood a few years ago, and I think the world has got to that point of understanding that in some places, and we live in one of them, conservation is not enough. The Atlantic forest has lost much more than it would be capable of healthily sustaining multiple species, one of the hottest of hotspots around the world. And again, here Andrew already showed us a graph that brings optimism. Again, a combination of policy action, in this case, surprisingly, from a Congress in 2000. Some record, yes, well, sorry. Took an action, but also that action came from the work of scientists, of NGOs, and a lot of societal pressure. And linking to your point, Andrew, about the hunting of hogs for the benefit of peasants, but more generally, the point about how we sometimes forget about the huge achievement and how hard it was to get to that. The Atlantic Forest Law is now under attack by the Congress. And I don't know if you saw, they already passed one measure that would weaken it. And if we allow, they will severely weaken it. So I think a very current example in Brazil about the importance of that. To wrap it up with restoration, during the roads to the new Global Biodiversity Agreement in Montreal, we understood the restoration through multiple focus groups that the CBD held worldwide, that the message that comes with restoration, that message of this is how it was before and this is what we can do, was very, very powerful. So the whole agreement was under the sort of the spirit of bending the curve or being nature positive. The fact that we can be the first human generation that will leave the planet with more nature than we found. If we meet the goals of that agreement, this process that started 10,000 years ago, the expansion of agriculture, it will be the first generation to see it reversed at a global scale. And for that, we need both conservation and restoration. And I believe that, paraphrasing another great African-American inspiring leader, yes, we can do that.
Thank you. I have a headline here, was not addressed to anyone specifically, so whoever is comfortable to answer. It says, the legal Amazon pollutes like an international country, any country, but does not generate wealth or investment into the same proportion. The region accounts for less than 90% of the national GDP, while generating half of Brazilian greenhouse gas emissions. I'm not even sure if this is, if it is published, it's a news from internet. So anyone would you like to address how to tackle optimism?
it up again. I'm not sure if I understood the question, but I can miss the opportunity to put what Bernardo just said, that Andrew, about the importance of that discourse. I mean, it's very powerful to say what do you have now and where we can be in the foreseeable future if we do that. And a couple of years ago, I saw an analysis of the speech of Martin Luther King and others, and they follow a common pattern, which is making this contrast, like, I have a dream where people can be free and whatever, but this is the real world. But we can make a change. We can be here if we do that and that, and that will be brilliant, and we'll be together a lot. But there's a problem, and we come down here. That's the same pattern that Steve Jobs uses to present the iPhone. Like, imagine if you could have a tool that makes this. But today, we're doing that. But if we could do that, but today, and then at the end, I'm presenting iPhone. So my question would be, two questions. First, what is the importance of communication on that? It's not just about science, not just about facts, not just about being science backed up, but on how we communicate and how do you see and how do you all see the importance of communication in the job that we do and that we all do in the classes that we're taking or the places that we work. And then maybe a more critical one, are we failing in communicating and not as much as in science? I mean, we already have all the information that we need to act, but we don't know how to communicate that.
Okay. I think this partly a problem with communication. Obviously, there's loads of science we still need to do about what's going on in the environment, about what works, and a lot of science around the psychology of persuading people. Not just psychology, but you look at the advertising industry, they manage to persuade us through some relatively simple tricks to spend our lives pursuing things we don't need. Imagine if we could put that intelligence and those methods to persuading people to spend a fraction of that effort for things that we really need, but people don't make money out of, so they're not being paid to communicate. Anyway, so I think there's real scope for science there. There's one example comes, and this doesn't answer your question fully, but I think it's worth sharing. It's from some work that Nancy Knowles put me in towards, which was about a really nice experiment where people were, the real world people were going to have some real world operation. I can't remember what it was, but it's an extremely painful series of processes. Oh, it can be very painful. I think the experimental intervention was two different treatments. One group, and there's a 10% chance you will suffer extreme pain during this procedure. I can't remember what it is. One group got the bad news first and then the good news. The bad version of this and the good bad version, like the other way around. So the bad version is, really sorry, you've got to have this treatment. There's a 10% chance this is going to be really, really horrible. And the good news version is, you got this treatment, it might well, it's going to help. And there's a 90% chance it won't feel thing. I mean, I'm paraphrasing. And you either got the good news first, followed by the bad news, or the bad news followed by the good news. Now, the interesting thing there is, of course, at the end of that, before you start your treatment, you've had both exposures. You've been told the thing both ways. Nevertheless, when people reported back on their experience, those who heard the bad news first reported that they had a more negative experience, even though they got the same balance of information. Order really matters. That's something I didn't know about. I think there's a lot of work like that in psychology that we need to use in terms of improving our communications. So lots of science that's needed, but I think the science, you know, because a lot of us are biologists in the field, you know, we a lot of people in conservation NGOs do, you know, are, I think we lack some of that science and that, which can which I think can really make a difference. So that's just it's a bit of science in action. So I think there's lots of science to be done that can help with communicating.
Just quickly coming back to the question about the Amazon. Just no answer, just to mention to those interested that there's an amazing project going on for about 3 years now. It's called the Amazonia 2030, which is a collection of studies and very serious work by multiple scientists in Brazil and abroad, led by both Amazon and CPI, based here, with contributions from IIS and multiple other organizations that have been systematically looking at an answer to that. What could be a plan that would both reduce the negative footprint currently the, let's say, Amazonian economy has in the world, but as important, deliver development for the people who live there. So they look into everything. And the key aspect is most of the answers are in the cities. When we discuss about Amazon, we usually think about rural. A fraction of the people who live in the Amazon live in rural areas. The great majority of the population live in urban cities, and improving the quality of life there is a key part of this answer.
Thank you.
I find also to address that question. And I think it has to do with some of our premises, I guess. So how we calculate GDP and how important it is, I think, is part of that. So if most of the energy in Brazil comes from the Amazon and the GDP is generated in these other places, I would say that the Amazon is responsible for most of our GDP because energy comes from there and nothing stays there. And there are many people in the Amazon with no access to energy at all. And at the same time, saying that the Amazon is a high emission of CO2, it's important to say that 80% of that, not only in the Amazon, but in the whole of Brazil, comes out of illegal deforestation. So it's a matter of calling the police, actually. And if you consider that a lot of that, you have, you know, people in politics and different types of interests running it, then again, it's something that should be, of course, as difficult as drug traffic to deal with because it's a business as big as that, but at the same time, it's achievable because we have already the legal background to avoid that. And you can also think in the opposite way, also to address this question. If you cut down all the forests in the Amazon, what's going to happen with the GDP of the world that depends on stable climate? So how we think about the future is very important for us to make sure that we take correct action in the present. But if our premises about the future is that the same as in the present, you're not going to change it.
Thank you. Another question was not addressed to anyone in particular. The same banks that finance oil trading support sustainable finance. Is it possible to drive change before the green movement is swollen by short-term profit-driven capitalism? How can we avoid that?
I think the conversation about optimism, it of course, I think it has to do with a vision of the future. And then we can think of utopias as a key word there. And I think that oftentimes when we think about the future, we think of the future as a measure of success of in many ways. And then you draw a map for that. And then the utopias become some kind of a blueprint. So again, it's easy for us to blame capitalism or to blame communism or whichever political, economical technology people use. But I think technologies, most times, they're not the problem. The problem is whatever is behind the technology. So I think that the question is very much about which kinds of transformation we need to go ourselves before we use technologies in a more adequate way. So it's not about whether capitalism has to change, but it's more about whether we can change in which time span this is going to be possible or not. I think it's not about finding specific group to blame. And I think that when Andrew speaks about hope, I believe that hope is something that's inside us. It's very individual. And I think everybody carries that. It's what makes you wake up in the morning. And hope, I believe, is something that you can spread. But it's not about waiting. It's about taking action. Or no action.
Mm-hmm.
In some cases, it's not a case of taking action. But I think hope's the key. It's more than a key word for me than optimism. And then I like very much Ariano Suassuna, I quoted many times. He often says he was called an optimist. And I don't know, I'm a hopeful realist. And I think, of course, when we look at reality, I think we show that almost everything in the world improved in the past 40 years. Almost every indicator, I do that in the class. Pick an indicator 20 years ago, 30 years ago, see how it was then, here for Brazil, for real, and see how it is now. It always improved. Three things did not improve: greenhouse gas emission, species loss, and inequality.
Mm-hmm.
These three can be connected to capitalism, of course, but it can also be connected to communism, to socialism, to any other social, political, economic system. We have seen the history of this planet. So it's not about the system, it's about us. And then, of course, that depends. And then somebody will say, well, that depends on how you vote. Well, if your premise is that if that's still the best way to do things. Democracy is about the power of the people, it's not necessarily about one specific type of. Do we have democracy here in Brazil? Do we have democracy anywhere in the world? I don't know.
Just on this one to follow up, students probably heard me saying this before, but the capitalism system is awful, has multiple flaws, and hopefully will be addressed. But in the meantime, it allows you to do one thing, going back to vote and change, is to vote with your money, all of us. So bringing a responsibility to us, consumers. Because if there's one thing companies react, banks, quite quickly, is to change in consumer patterns. They must, otherwise they die, they go broke. And that there are examples. Examples in companies that didn't adopt dolphin-friendly tuna nets and didn't have the
label
and certificate of dolphin-friendly in their tuna cans back in the 80s. Those that didn't, they went bust. So the whole sector adopted it. Relatively quickly. There was a change in consumer behavior. Unfortunately, they are all too rare yet. And I like to take that blame to us, to put that one on our shoulders, because then we can act. Take responsibility, not blame, responsibility is the better word. So I think we can vote with how we spend. And that makes change between the capitalism system.
Maybe just thinking about banks, it could be not just business,
I guess it could be some kind of a generational change. Like we're not, it, like Fabio said, if you think about 10 years ago, 30 years ago, it would be imaginable to think of a bank investing in nature or doing things like that. They will focus on oil and gas and everything. That's the usual business. So this is changing, but I don't think it's just business. Just because it's a new business to restore nature or there is some kind of business involved in biodiversity conservation, it sure is. But there must be some kind of generational change and the leadership's changing and people are thinking different. And again, addressing my first question, in a given time, maybe we'll have people that think differently. The other day, I saw a research that tells that 50% of the youth in the world thinks they will be will have a better future than their parents had. That's a lot of people, optimists. 50% think that the world will be better for them than they were for the parents. And among all the catastrophes and climate change and everything that we're seeing, there are half of the youth thinking that, yeah, future will be better. So maybe this is some kind of a change that is coming, that people that think differently, and they are now starting to occupy strategic places like a manager in the bank or leading some kind of new business focused on restoring nature and everything. Maybe, I don't know.
So you have been bombarded with so many bad news, and I think now we all feel much more optimistic. So thank you very much. I have just one very last question to Andrew, and then we are coming to an end. Andrew, we have been now in Brazil for a few months. Which conservation initiative here impressed you most? Positively, of course.
Re.green. I think that would be, it's difficult to. I think that's difficult to. I've seen lots and lots of successes, and I've seen I've met lots of extraordinary people. And fundamentally, successes come down to people, actually, who are passionate and driven. And energetic and decent. I think.
Sorry.
Okay. Well, I'll mention the Cayman example, not because that. I mean, it's a very specific one, but Sarah and I visited an institute called the Instituto Marcos Daniel in Espírito Santo. Some of you might know. I visited it because I'm a trustee for a UK organisation that's helping to support, along with many other. Then is helping to support the restore of forest, well, safeguard and then restore the forest in the north of Espírito Santo, where they're doing amazing work. What I didn't know was anything else about their work, so I got talking about other things they did. And one of the ways was amazing. It's so they're based in Victoria. Cayman, as you probably know, the Atlantic Forest Cayman is in trouble. In many of the natural habitats, it's already disappeared. And they had an opportunity. They're passionate about Cayman as biologists. They had an opportunity because I think it's called ArcelorMittal, which is the company that runs the big steelworks there, has a problem because Cayman, while they're doing badly in natural habitats, they're thriving in the city. There's lots of food and fauna, dogs and things like that. And so they're doing well and they're protected. And so every so often, very large Cayman wanders out and lays itself on the tracks in the middle, the railway track in the middle of the ArcelorMittal plant. And they have to stop the train, and that stops the whole factory, and it costs them a fortune. So they get in touch. Oh, what can you do? Anyway, so the person in the center of this, who's a very enterprising person, I know, we can run a conservation project, which would be to capture Cayman, not just from you, but anywhere else where people have a problem in their streets, in their playgrounds, wherever it is, and we'll take them and put them in forests, which are safe now, but which are empty of Cayman. So that's what they do. It's very clever. They've got, I think, 15 years continuous funding from ArcelorMittal. They save, you know, they solve the problem for them. But the really clever thing is that every time a Cayman wanders into a school playground, everyone gets very excited. And so it's a story. And so every few weeks, they're on the television, saving this cave, Cayman, saving the local people,
putting it back, giving it a name, all that stuff. It's a fantastic way of, you know, getting money from people that, you know, what's a steel company doing paid conservation? But they are, and then they're using it to raise their profile as conservation. And doing that, you know, doing many other projects as a result. So I'm not saying that's the most impressive. It's just what I didn't know about. And it illustrates a point which I found in lots of examples that inspire me, which is that one thing we do, which is a limitation, is we look at problems as conservationists. We look at the problem of the species. And so if we see everything as a nail, the only tool we've got is a hammer. But if you can see the problem from other people's perspective, in that case, how do I get these damn things off my railway? Then you can come up with some novel and interesting insights that speak to their problem. And then they can endure and they can be sustained. So that's an illustration for me of the importance of lateral thinking and of us taking a humble approach to a problem, trying to see the problem from the perspective of other stakeholders who've got completely different issues and troubles. That's just one example. But of course, it's easy.
Thank you very much.
We are moving towards the end of the event, and we would like to count on your participation once again to answer one last question. So the same QR code, you have another interaction. That is, we would like you to share a personal positive story or news about nature conservation. Em português, latente português, gostaríamos que vocês compartilhassem uma história pessoal ou alguma notícia sobre a conservação da natureza. Yes, if anyone wants to participate here in person, just come to the stage. You can raise your hand or via online participation as well. Aline, please.
Recently we restore, the International Institute for Sustainability, 250 hectares of native vegetation of the Brazilian Atlantic Forest through No Caminho da Mata Atlântica project in the Rio de Janeiro state.
Thank you.
Still the same thing, but I think one of the most impressive stories I know, it inspired me a lot. Here in our city, the Tijuca National Park is about 3,000 hectares, to give the scale. Over the last 40 years, we gained another 3,000 hectares of forest in the city of Rio through a project called Reflorestamento, a partnership with prefeitura, NGOs, technical people, academic, and the communities where they happen. And a bottom-up approach with technical support has brought back to this city over the last 40 years, 3,000 hectares of Atlantic forest. I think this is really, really inspiring. Should be talking a bit more about it.
Ooh, very interesting. Anyone else? Online? All good. So this event was the inaugural lecture for the sustainability course and also the first CSRio seminar. This semester, instead of having seminars every 2 to 3 weeks, our seminars will have a different format. Mateus, please come to the stage. So we are happy to announce that this year, CSRio is introducing a new format for its content. In addition to the traditional seminars, the video podcast will soon be released.
Yes. Good night.
So I have to read. In this first season, we'll cover the Sustainability Development Goals, the SDGs, and we will invite professors, alumni, and other people from the Master in Sustainability Science. So the aim is to promote and disseminate the knowledge on the subject to the public, as well as showcase impactful work developed by our alumni. So, back to you.
And Mateus, we are almost forgotten the main thing. The name of the video podcast is the same that Andrew talks, is Earth Optimism, or in Portuguese, Otimismo Planetário. Yes. And the episode will be published in May. So we see you soon on now on the network.
Yeah.
Yes, of course. Então, nós convidamos a todos agora para vocês estarem conosco no nosso novo projeto do CSRio, que vai ser um vídeo podcast que vai abordar os objetivos de desenvolvimento sustentável. E em cada episódio, a gente vai discutir com um ex-aluno, um aluno ou um professor do curso do mestrado em Ciência da Sustentabilidade sobre um ODS específico. A gente está muito animado. Essa vai ser a primeira temporada de muitas, assim esperamos. E é isso, convidamos vocês para nos juntarem em breve. Agora em maio vai ser o primeiro episódio. Obrigada, gente. Thank you very much.
Essa é uma novidade desse semestre, porque tradicionalmente os nossos seminários sempre eram ou online ou presencialmente, e agora vão ter essa série de podcasts. Vamos ver, espero que vocês gostem. So, coming back to the end of the event, we hope you enjoyed, and once again, I would like to express our deepest gratitude to our speaker, Andrew Balmford, for his very insightful, optimistic presentation. And also big thanks to the representatives of co-hosting institutions, Bernardo, Fabio, and Rafa. And thank you very much all for your presence here. Thank you very much everybody that who joined us online. And of course, big thanks to our production team, Fernanda, Mateus, Breno, Adriano, and of course, our master of ceremony, Dani. Thank you, please. So, see you at the happy hour. Yeah, now we all go to planetarium and see you at the next event. Good night.
Yes. I'm going to